Welcome to StormCast, the official Warhammer Age of Sigmar podcast.
Hello, and welcome to StormCast, the official Warhammer Age of Sigmar podcast, brought to you by the Warhammer community team, three times a week, talking everything from the Mortal Realms, Warhammer Age of Sigmar rules, and all the latest news and announcements about the new edition that's on the way. And we've got another great episode for you.
Yeah, we've got some really cool guests today. We've got loremaster Phil Kelly, who's going to talk about sort of where the Mortal Realms are at right now.
Not a literal loremaster from the Mortal Realms.
I mean, I don't know. He's pretty sort of mystical.
Yeah. Do you think he casts a spell?
Yeah, I heard that idea of someone that sort of knows everything was based on Phil Kelly. Yeah. and then after that, we've got Pete from the playtest team to talk about one of the biggest and most exciting changes to the new edition, which is summoning's free now.
Yeah, free summoning. Get your free units. Skinks, yeah. Carnosaurs, bloodletters.
Pretty much anything you like. Yeah, Chaos Spawn.
Lots of stuff. Yeah. Cool. It's going to be a good episode. And we're going to start, as always, with the latest news from the Mortal Realms. Welcome to the news from the Mortal Realms. We've had some very exciting announcements on the Warhammer community website this week, one of which I think was of particular interest to you, Rory.
As I may have mentioned once or twice, Eddie, I don't know if you know, but I'm a big Beast of Chaos
fan. Is news to me. In all their forms.
It's like basically like dragon ogres, anything of hooves, anything of horns, little bit Zangor.
Hooves and horns, you're in, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm there. I'm sold. Take me away. But,
so we found out a little bit about some of a new spell that they've got.
Yeah, so this is a really cool change. So as well as keeping all their General's Handbook abilities, the Bray Shaman's getting a new spell called Devolve, which is a really, really fun one where basically you pick an enemy unit and you drag it forcibly towards you. We've seen the Slaughter Priest is a quite similar ability. Yep. I think it's going to be really fun for like pulling people out of position, grabbing one of those characters that might think they're sort of safe behind their unit and just sort of making them pop out the front.
Yeah, very cool news for Beasts of Chaos fans everywhere, Rory included, obviously. Also, we found out a little bit about the Free Peoples.
Yeah, Free Peoples are a really, really cool army. I think they've been a surprisingly like effective and powerful one. I know Reese from Frontline Gaming really, really likes them. So I think they're going to be in a really strong place in the new edition, not least because of the new rules which let you dedicate your army to a particular realm.
Yeah, so these are some really, really cool rules that are on their way. Basically, before the game starts, when you're building your army, you can basically pick one of the seven Mortal Realms and say, my army is from this realm. And when you do that, it gives you access to 12 new magic items, 6 weapons and 6 kind of arcane or enchanted items.
And that's not 12 overall, that's 12 per Mortal Realms. That's 84 overall, if I've done my maths right.
Yeah, it's close enough.
Yeah. I think these are really, really fun. Like, magical artifacts are really cool. It's nice to customize things. I love my big heroes and stuff like that. So I think I'm really excited to see how these work from a gaming perspective or how they work from a roleplay perspective.
I think from a narrative perspective, they're a really fun way to kind of ground your army in those Mortal Realms. So I'm looking forward to see how people use those. So there you go. That's a quick wrap-up of the latest news from the Mortal Realms. Hello and welcome back. We are joined by Pete from the Warhammer Age of Sigmar playtest group, and today we're going to be talking about summoning in the new edition. Pete, thank you ever so much for joining us. So summoning is going to go through a pretty big change for this new edition. Do you want to talk us briefly through the kind of the key mechanics of that?
Well, in my opinion, it's going to be probably the biggest and probably the most controversial change that's coming to AOS 2. Because currently, if you want to have any summoning in an army, you've got to pay summoning points. So you've got a 2,000 point army, you perhaps put 200 points to side to bring a unit on. With AOS 2, that's all gone. You have your 2,000 point army, and then there's mechanics which each individual army has to raise new units for free, effectively. Be it points for casting magic, like a Zinch army does, or your Nurgle, where they get contagion points, and they add up to make a unit, or the death armies, which can just bring back summon back units to the field. These are all different armies, have all different mechanics, and there's some armies out there that are going to suffer because they don't have that same mechanic. So one or two of the armies that I've played, Zinch obviously is probably the most magical army in Warhammer at the moment. Very powerful, lots of mortal wound output, and the way they work at the moment is, every time a spell is cast and it's not unbound, so albeit, you know, you can cast 4, 5, 6 spells, then they will get a summoning point, which is called a fate point. And the amount of fate points add up, and there's a table, and it tells you what you can summon.
It starts off small with, like, horrors and stuff, and works your way all the way up to Greater Demon at the top.
Yeah, and he's 36 points, so you're not going to get him straight.
Cast a lot of spells to get that guy. you have to throw a lot of pyrotechnics around before he's impressed enough to show up.
But say you're playing a load of change army against a Nagash, who can cast 6, 7 spells, and he's casting 6 or 7 spells. You are getting points.
So it's when your enemies do spells as well?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
He gets it from everywhere.
You don't even have to cast any spells if you're against like another magic army.
And the interesting thing, and something that I could get me around at first, is, well, if I cast a spell at you, I might say, you know, it's an 18-inch range spell, you're 20 inches away, I can't cast. You can still cast a spell. You can't unbind it because I've cast it. Even though it's not successful, it's a successfully cast spell. It has no effect.
So there's some sneaky ways of racking up some extra points. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's for Zinj. People like Korn, their mechanics change.
It's probably to do with taking heads, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, yeah. At the moment, they have the blood tithe points. And now with Korn, then they will have, instead of spending on blood tithe points, the blood tithe points add up. Instead of getting units, abilities that they do now, they get units. So if it starts at 2 for something like 5 blood letters, and then it goes all the way up to 18, I think it is, for a greater demon, a Korn.
Yeah, so again, you have to spill quite a lot of blood before you've impressed Korn.
So it gives you an option, do I need more troops to kill more, or do I need that extra ability to get that charge in when I need to? Though that's Korn. And similarly, like Slaanesh, they've got an ability where the heroes, if they kill things, or if they wound things but don't kill things, they get points. Slaan, I think they get things like...
They kind of summoned constellations together, don't they? And the Astaloth bearer, I think, helps them too. Yeah.
So to me, I think that is going to be a massive change, and people are going to have to think how they want their armies to play. How can they counter that? You know, playing magic heavy armies don't cast spells, so a Zinj army isn't getting. You know,
some interesting stuff. It's like, well, I want this spell cast, but I really don't want them to get the extra point to be able to summon this unit. So maybe I won't cast all the spells I was hoping on casting. I think it's really cool how each one is very thematic to the army as well. So it's not like everybody's got the same ability and it's just spells.
No.
It's you know, the Zinj one is very much about magic. The Korn one's very much about killing stuff, and all of them kind of fit in with the theme of their army.
Yeah. I mean, like the undead. That again is a different mechanic to anything else, because it comes back to the command point system where the general or whoever, if a unit's been wiped out, then you can spend a command point to raise that whole unit. So say you've had 40 skeletons, which are quite a good unit, that it takes you 3 turns to get through, and all of a sudden they're back on table. But then again, it gives the opponent that ability that, knowing that, they can shut it down by stopping the grave marker, you know, standing around the grave markers and things like
that. Yeah, all of these abilities have got a counter in some way, shape, or form. Yeah.
It's like a lot of the abilities as well, when you're summoning the units, it's at the end of the movement phase. So you do your move, you've got your summoning points, end of the movement phase, and they've got to be raised within, not within 9 inches of the enemy, and wholly within, say, 9 inches or 12 inches of a hero or something like that. So there are restrictions, so there are ways of countering it, but it's still a very powerful mechanic.
Oh, we were talking about this before in terms of how you put your army together.
Yeah.
And we were looking at the Seraphon and we thought, oh, there's actually quite a lot of ways to build kind of summon ability into a Seraphon list, but you almost have to sacrifice some other stuff in the army to fit it in.
You've got to take a pretty weighty investment, I think. Like, so Korn, I think, is the one army where like you get your summon basically whatever kind of army you're playing, because like stuff's going to die, you're going to be generating blood tithe. I think like a Seraphon army is more like where you go like, right, here's my Slaan, here's my Astrolith Bearer, I'm going to accept that I'm going to get 3 less casts in a turn. Like that's what my list's going to be about. Yeah. It's like a new archetype, I suppose.
And then there's obviously other units, such as, say, Elarial, which is an intrinsic ability that, I mean, once per, every turn she can get D3 wounds back to each unit, but then once per game, she can bring a tree man on.
Yeah.
So effectively, Elarial gets a free tree.
Comes with a free tree lord, yeah. That's pretty cool.
So, yeah, or different levels of units.
And there's a lot of... abilities that maybe you don't see used all that often in the current edition of Warhammer Age of Sigmar in match play, certainly, because they used to cost points, whereas now they're like, oh, actually my Vortex Beast can all of a sudden create spawns, which is pretty cool.
Or
the Screaming Bell, I think, is one we were looking at, which is pretty cool. So every now and again you get a free Vermin Lord.
I think some vampire characters that used to kill something, you get something else.
That's a good one.
I can't remember what it was.
I think it's the throne, isn't it? The Coven throne.
Could be, yeah.
Well, like flesh eater courts of this one, I think, in the new command point change. I think people are saying a really nice allied attachment, like a Ghoul King. Then you bring on a courtier, that brings on more units, and you can sort of have this sort of little chain reaction where suddenly you're just multiplying all your flesh eater units on the table, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, so overall, as I say, it's going to make people think about what army they want to buy and play. And then, obviously, when they're facing that type of army, how to mitigate the strength of that, because it is strong, because effectively you're getting troops for free, albeit that, you know, the army will have paid for that.
And maybe restricted itself in other ways to kind of fit that summon ability into its forces. Yeah. Brilliant. Well, thank you ever so much for joining us, Pete, and sharing your expertise on summoning in the new edition. We're going to be back very soon with our next segment. Welcome back. We are joined by the wonderful Phil Kelly from the studio's Warhammer Age of Sigmar background team. Phil, thank you ever so much for joining us.
No problem.
So you are one of the team behind the new edition's background for Warhammer Age of Sigmar. Some fairly big changes in store for the Mortal Realms. Do you want to give us kind of a quick overview of what we can look forward to?
Absolutely. Okay, so I got a privileged position of essentially filling in the gaps of the Age of Sigmar that we've done thus far, tying it together and doing a lot of world building. Now, we'd already sketched out, as you know, from the original Age of Sigmar, we'd already sketched out this great epic canvas, which is full of myths and legends and gods battling huge monsters and zodiacal beasts. So we'd got the almost like the sort of broad operatic sweep of it and the real kind of mythological bedrock of Age of Sigmar. We've already put that in there. And that's before the Stormcast Eternals sort of lightning strike into play. So we had a lot of myths, a lot of legends. But what we've done now is look deeper into that and say, okay, so several generations later, what is it like to live in those worlds? Now, we know the Age of Chaos basically claimed the vast majority of the mortal realms. They were under the heel of the tyrant and the oppressor, and it was not a good place to be. But as I mentioned, the Stormcast Eternals have struck in and started to win back civilization bit by bit. And they've done this the hard way. They've had to fight and die over and over again to make this happen, but they've made progress. So there are new cities, there are realm gates that are under control of the Order Alliance, and the tenuous allies that they have with Dwardian and Elves. They're starting to pull it back together again.
Sounds like everything's going to be fine.
Yeah, not so much. Because Chaos is obviously an eternal threat, and they're not going to give up without a fight. Some of the Chaos Gods are actually on the rise. We've seen Khorne, who was initially in the first Age of Sigmar books. He was loving it. It was like Khorne's paradise, really, because it was all barbarism and death and skulls and blood, rivers of blood. That was pretty much about what Khorne wanted, really. But now he's got a new force to fight against the Stormcast Eternals. He's no longer hunting refugees and fishermen. He's actually fighting like massive golden armies and these new interesting new paladins of Sigmar. So Khorne's okay with it. Tzeentch, well, he's the changer of the ways, the god of manipulation. He's also thriving, really, because the new cities are established and we've got aristocrats and dynasties and politics.
Intrigue, isn't it?
Exactly. He's well down with that. And Slaanesh, to some extent, as well, as some of the these palaces, you know, they have luxuries and weird hidden cults and, you know, that's fertile ground.
Tribal barbarians don't throw very good parties.
They don't. They're certainly very, very bloody ones, I would imagine. You've got the, essentially, it's not like Chaos is on the back foot. It's rising to meet the challenge that's being presented. But also we have Death. We have Death as this thriving faction, personified by, of course, Nagash, the supreme necromancer.
You have to say it in the voice.
You have to say that. I've tried for capital. Did you hear the capital letters?
I did, all caps.
So Nagash is our god of undeath. He wants to be the god of death and the god of all the realm of death, Shaish, but he's not quite there yet. And he has this great megalomaniacal plan to take over all of the underworlds, all the heavens and hells of Shaish and make them his.
Sounds nice. Yeah.
He is undoubtedly a lunatic and evil god.
It's a big giant floating skeleton that's like...
There's a clue there, isn't there? Yeah, there's a clue. That's how he laughs, Rory. Well done. But he's got this this ambition, which is, might take millennia to come to pass, but Nagash is a patient guy. And part of that is he's done this great spell, this great ritual called the Necroquake, which is rippled out through reality. But it didn't go quite as planned. Nothing really does in the Warhammer universe. And that tiny bit of disruption at the end of his great scheme has caused magic to go haywire. Magic, which was formerly, people were beginning to learn how to avoid it or even how to use it, has now become a force of nature. And when you cast a spell, sometimes it stays cast and roams around the lands as almost like a predatory force, giant burning head or a weird amethyst sun that turns you to a statue. So magic is essentially on the rise at this point. Which enables us to tell even cooler stories of bounty hunters who are sent out into the wilds to dispel roving spells or hunt them down or gain magic items. So there's a whole suite of new stories. But what we've tried to do is blend all that epic mythic stuff with the the more gritty realism that some of our hobbyists will be familiar with, where we look through the eyes of a common man or a common soldier or dwarf or elf even, and tell their story.
I think through the eyes of a common man is almost always terrifying as well.
In these worlds. Yeah.
I sort of see it as like a kind of mythic realism, where it's like, well, if you have like a place where like sort of lava sort of flows up and everything's made of crystal, like how do you make a living there?
Yeah.
Like I love how each free city almost has its own kind of gimmick where it's manipulating the unique character of its realm
to
trade some resource or something. It's
absolutely
really cool.
Yeah, so we've got Hammerhall Aksha, Hammerhall Giren that trade lava and healing water and so forth, as you were saying. But essentially what we've tried to do is invest a lot of time and effort in the depth of this and enable it to be fertile ground for you guys to tell your stories and an open canvas, something that we can extrapolate from, our miniatures designers can make new races in and they will fit straight in. So it's got tremendous potential. And I think as you read more of it, you'll realize that this is definitely a work that's going to span decades, and it'll be a lot of fun going along for the ride.
Brilliant. Well, Phil, thank you ever so much for joining us. That was incredibly interesting. I hope that the guys listening along at home have enjoyed that too. We're going to be back in after a very quick break for our last segment.
Well, it looks like the story for the Mortal Realms is moving in some really, really interesting directions. Thanks again for joining us. Let us know your thoughts on the Warhammer Age of Sigmar Facebook page and follow all the latest episodes on Warhammer Community.